Exactly.
Well, welcome, everyone. Gary Shapiro, the CEO of the CEA. Hey.
What's happening, Gary?
Hi, John. It's great to be here.
Thanks for coming. So, you're late.
Yeah.
What's up with that?
The dog ate my homework.
Oh, okay.
I was at another interview that said it would be 5 minutes, and they went 15 because I was so fascinated.
We do that to other people, so I can totally understand
that. Well, my favorite thing about having you around is you are always so happy.
I know.
I mean, you're like the highest energy person I know.
That's very kind. Part of it is the people I'm with.
Right.
Let's be honest.
I know that.
Just trying to impress her, you know.
I know that, yeah.
And the passion that comes from you. Super passionate guy. We were having dinner yesterday, and I was just amazed. You were talking about something I don't even care about, politics. But it was really fascinating because you are passionate about that topic. So.
Well, you know, my mother was an encyclopedia salesman. She sold World Book. You're too young.
Yeah.
Encyclopedias open their pages.
And they put information in the pages.
Right.
The information doesn't change.
It stays
for like 100 years.
And so my mother always said, you could sell anything if you're passionate about it and believe in it, but if you don't, forget it. So I'm fortunate that I am so excited about this industry and what it's doing for the world and for people and their access to information, entertainment for pennies an hour, that I think I have the best job in the world.
Yeah.
I agree. You have a very good job. I think
I have the best
job in the world because I work with Callie.
Ha ha.
I understand that, actually.
He has to sit here with me all day, so he's just buttering me up. But you actually have your hands in technology, even more so than we do, probably.
Yeah. Because you're on all levels.
Yeah, you're on all levels. And you really focus on helping people, you know, adopt certain new technologies.
Like when HDTV came out, remove
those roadblocks. I'd love to hear what you're working on right now. That you could share with the audience.
Well, what's exciting that's coming out, I mean, you know, HDTV to me is one of the most greatest things I've ever worked at. I joke that when I'm buried, I want to be in my tomb will be 16:9 aspect.
Oh, nice. You know?
So, to be remembered that way. But you know, there was a lot of emphasis on 3D, and I always said 3D is overhyped, it's a feature. But the next big thing in video, at least, is 4K. Or Ultra HD or whatever. And we're really moving quickly into that. We've established a framework as an industry to proceed. We've gotten already buy-in from, like, think of it from Hollywood to the studios, major retailers who see an opportunity for packaged goods again, and every transmission carrier saying, how are we going to make this happen? Because people are getting these beautiful, new, skinny, bright sets, and then they realize, you know what, they're really big, you could see those pixels.
Yeah. Right,
we want to make it clean and crisp. So that's exciting. And then there's, you know, we were talking last night about the driverless car and what's happening and how that's going to change society and reduce accidents and make a difference in lives and maybe cost jobs of drivers.
Yep.
And so there's so many ramifications of that, and we talk about in Washington and elsewhere.
Yeah.
And then there's just the concept of how we get goods and how we invent. And the thing that really turns me on, frankly, is the whole concept of innovation.
Yeah.
So we're at an event here. There's the CES. We design those events so anyone with an idea can expose that to literally tens of thousands of investors, retailers, media like yourselves, partners. And that makes such a difference. And now when you're doing things like that, you need other people to work with. And you need a face-to-face. As much as I love technology, face-to-face, five senses in play, you're evaluating people. That's very important.
Yeah. Yep.
And also innovation is very important for our economy. Our economy is floundering. The world economy is floundering. Innovation is what makes a difference. Innovation creates economic activity. It creates jobs. It moves us along. And that's what we need, and that's why I'm excited.
If everybody keeps just kind of divvying up and rehashing the same old stuff, you essentially perfect and commoditize it.
Exactly.
But when you're bringing out and innovating and bringing in new things to market where there's no real competition for them, there's margin to be had, new jobs are created, good stuff is occurring.
Yeah,
so,
exactly.
Speaking of good stuff occurring, I don't know if you've had much time here because you've been running around a lot, but there's a lot of cool stuff, like new, not like it wasn't released at CES earlier in the year. There's new stuff coming out right here
now,
today.
The CEA line shows have been going on for about 5 years,
This is the fifth year.
And last year we did notice a little bit of, like, the
there was some new stuff, but not as much as this year.
Not as much as this year is what I'm
trying to say.
What are you
seeing?
Well, we see a tremendous amount of growth and new stuff. honestly, I haven't had a chance to walk around much.
Yeah.
I'm hearing
right.
great things from people like you. So this event has grown 30% in 1 year. It's hopefully will keep growing because this is a very rapidly changing industry. There are a lot of things coming down the pike, whether you talk about robotics or biometrics or all the sorts of new apps. Or
he
new
said robotics first just
I,
for you.
I know.
She loves robots so much.
Oh, yeah. Robots are my thing.
Well, she is a robot.
No, I'm not.
Little known fact. Anyway, go ahead. Sorry.
That's a great idea for a new robot is to call it the Callie and have it that's look right. like her. I mean, could you imagine
You'd
what
sell a lot of Callie robots.
Callie robot. Callie robot. You want to start a business?
I do. Callie Let's robots. Do it. Let's do it.
Can you license us the name?
No. I think well, we can get, I got to talk to my CEO.
We can get funding for that, I'm pretty sure.
I bet you could.
That's
no,
right.
I mean, but in all seriousness, you know, wouldn't you love to come back in 10, 20, or 30 years and see what's out there?
Yeah.
You know, there's such great developments in sensing devices, in robotics, in nanotechnology,
yes.
in the use of the internet itself, in a sense, machine-to-machine communication, in learning devices, that we're really, as exciting as this is, we're still at the very, very beginning.
Right.
Early, we're toddlers in this thing called digital and where we're going.
Yeah, it's funny.
Do you ever get scared about how fast we're moving and where things are going? Privacy and all of that?
You know, I don't. You know, I was a great reader of science fiction when I was young, and to me it's all very exciting. That's why I really think we're at the emphasis.
Yeah.
And some of the things I've read about have actually happened. And there's a lot of talk about privacy. And yeah, there are issues, but we always manage to work through them. When I was studying in school, there was a whole framework that we developed just for the use of credit cards. Which, so you're limited to $50 liability. You know what? You live with it. And credit cards have exploded, and now they're natural. Now we're saying the same thing to computers. Oh, your identity is going to be stolen, and things like that. A lot of it is overhyped. There are risks, and we do deal with them as a society. But the truth is you have to give up a little bit about it yourself. You have to tell your tailor your measurements to get clothes that fit you.
Right.
So I'm willing to give up information about myself. Maybe I should be more concerned and more paranoid. But I think overall, you know, society, like in New York City, like this city works.
Yep.
People get along.
Yeah.
99.99% of people are good people, and they really want to make things happen with each other. So I'm a believer in people as well as technology.
That's a good way to phrase it. I, you know, hope that everyone can trust everyone. Of course, there are some bad apples. But for me, for example, ads in my email or ads on my web searches, I want to actually see stuff that's relevant to me. Otherwise, I'm certainly not clicking it. You know,
I actually take the complete opposite approach. Like on Google, I've opted out of letting them customize the ads for me and stuff because I don't know why. I don't like the idea of being tracked. Even though I know they're doing it, Amazon, every time I log in, you can't opt out of it. When you log into Amazon and I buy God knows how much stuff from them, they show me related things, you know, compared to what
right.
I bought in the past. So clearly they're tracking it.
It is kind of funny because you see how you're being labeled by what you're going to. So my personal video, my TiVo, like several years ago, thought I was gay because I'd watched, I guess, a couple of programs.
Yeah.
And then the same thing happened on Facebook when I guess I signed up for a Million Man something where I said I support gay marriage or something.
Yeah.
And all of a sudden, I'm gay.
Yeah, yeah.
So you realize you are identifying yourself a certain way, and then you're getting
yes.
ads targeted.
Yeah.
And it does make you
But
a
they
little
change.
Sensitive.
They only do it for a little while, and then they kind of change the next thing that
right.
they think you're paying attention to.
Well, so, I tend to think about my searches ahead of time, and we'll go into like private mode if I don't really want anything coming up based
wow.
on that or something. Like medical stuff. Or,
I know, but
you know,
I mean,
stuff like that.
I never even thought about it. I've never gone into private mode
really?
Online. No.
I didn't even know how to go in a private
mode. Yeah.
I could turn my cookies off. That's about as far as I could go. And then you lose stuff. I mean, so it's like a lot of things in life is a trade-off. I mean, airline security is like that. I would go through naked just to get through there quicker. Because
right.
I don't want people touching me. I don't want to be touched by the machines.
That's funny because I do the opposite.
I do the opposite as well.
We refuse flatly to go through that backscatter machine.
Well, you travel
as have I.
As much as
okay.
we do. But you're saying
but
you
he, but hate being
it?
Touched. I mean,
I go for the free massage every time. I'm like, yes, bring it on.
You know what we heard?
Hey, do you guys
now,
have any questions for Gary, by the
yes,
way? If so, feed
them
to us. Watching all the chat rooms, so if you got questions,
this has nothing
ask
to do
now,
with
and then we'll ask them.
Actually, if you want to get frisked by the opposite sex,
Oh, this is my business model.
You just have to go in dressed as though you are the opposite sex.
Oh, that's true.
Which is a little bit of work, honestly. I don't know if it's that interesting to me.
Probably not. But it's a factoid. We learned recently.
Listen, I have a problem with...
I don't even think I should comment on this one.
I have a problem with the TSA because they're spending like $6 trillion, you know, and I don't think we're getting enough, you know, out of it. So I have a solution to all problems. And my solution is this. I think that, you know, they could offer as an optional service being frisked by the opposite sex. And you just pay a nominal fee, like $20, for example. See, and then they just hire really hot TSA agents.
Jeez.
And everybody will pay their $20. You don't need those expensive backscatter machines. It's like, here's my $20, give me my frisking, and I'll go get on the plane.
Well, you know, in Europe, I think the sex, whoever, it almost doesn't matter.
Yeah, they don't care.
But
right.
Since Europeans have a different concept of
privacy,
body cleansingliness.
Yeah. Oh, yeah.
It's not a very pleasant experience,
that's
at least
true,
for me.
That's true.
This is very,
all right,
getting very personal.
Deschelle in the chat
room.
Ben
likes my plan, okay?
What is...
I like Ben Rothig, but
yeah,
he says, a comment.
He says, can you stay a couple more hours? You're awesome. Gary's going to come co-host with us later on.
Send me an email.
That would be fun. You should co-host with us for a while.
That
That'd
would
be awesome.
Awesome. What do you have to do after this?
Yeah, right.
Just easy. So a question. Why is it called The Line Shows?
So, you know, we produced the International CES in Las Vegas, which is the most awesome event in the world. And
yes.
I just love it.
I love it, too.
Thank you.
I have not gotten tired of it. I love it.
So, and like next week, I'm going to be in China at a CES.
Yes.
And there's a story there, but it's not the same CES. And everyone thinks, oh, you could take CES and you could transplant in here. And what we learned is we can't do that. It's taken us 45 years to build up a CES in Las Vegas. So we have an event here. We could have called it CES Summer CES, yep, or New York CES. But we call it Line Shows because it's a matter of marketing expectation, frankly. And it's a lot of things. Expectations in life is everything. And you have to exceed expectations.
Yeah. Yeah.
So if they're too high, it's like the Beijing people. They did the Olympics, and they came to us, and they said, we want you to have the CES in Beijing, this great big event. And I looked at them, and I said, your expectations are too high. And they offered us a lot of things to do that.
Yeah.
And I said, you know, it took 100 years to build up the Olympics. You did a great job.
Yeah.
But you didn't create it. And a lot of things take time to build up. And
yeah,
that's what – so this line show has good – gradual growth, and that's important to us.
You know, we hear the exact same thing, and I'm glad you guys recognize that, because we have a lot of people who come to us and like, we really like what you guys do. We think it would be fun to do something like that ourselves, you know. And so could you just help us set that up, you know? And we're like, yeah. This took many years, you know. It's like, even if you started today, you're like 5 years minimum away if you get lucky enough to, you know, everything goes well, you know. It's
a lot of
people don't understand how much goes into it.
As a CEO of an organization and trying to position an industry, a lot of what I'm doing often is managing expectations, managing them of employees, of volunteers, of constituencies in Congress. You have to be honest. And my goal is always to set reasonable expectations and then really work hard to exceed them. And that's, I also do that in my marriage. Not always successfully, but I try. It's a good whole lesson for life thing.
What, the manage expectations?
Well, be honest. Exceed expectations.
If only I could exceed my wife's expectations. That poor woman's been with me for decades.
I don't know how she does it.
Gary,
speaking
I know
of family, you actually just had a baby, so congratulations.
Yes. My wife did, yes, but she did the heavy lifting. And, it was quite a surprise.
You held her hand.
Quite a surprise. You know, we were in China last July, and she was given this fertility painting, and they said, this makes you fertile, which was, we considered an impossibility, because my wife is what they call AMA,
right,
which means advanced maternal age, which was, she's beyond childbearing
supposedly
age, but supposedly,
yeah,
it turns out that wasn't the case. But we were blessed.
Yes.
That's what we say now.
See that little painting thing or whatever,
yes,
that did it.
Anyway, that's way too much for public consumption. I'm in trouble. She should ever watch this. But no, it's kind of a miracle, and it gives you perspective on life, which is very important.
Right, right.
Yes.
Well, should we let him answer this one last question?
Okay, one last question.
Just how do vendors brought into, are there selection process, or they just pay and they get a spot?
Well, so we run the CES, and even this event, so that anyone with a good idea can be exposed to it. And there's two ways. One is almost, you have to be connected to the industry somehow. You know, we don't want jewelry or something like that, unless there's an electronic component. Generally, you have to meet the criteria, and then you pay for it. But it's not expensive. It's really designed for a few thousand dollars to be exposed. In fact, our entire volunteer leadership seems to be composed of people who were entrepreneurs, who had an idea. You know, one person created her lunches for 4 days and her dinners and drove to our show and with a prototype and got funding. Now she's a successful exporting company, and there's a lot of stories like that. But another way, which is much smaller, is we do have some competitions. We have something called Eureka Park for startups. Yes. Yep. We subsidize their participation. It's growing very quickly, but we are so focused on the innovator, the entrepreneur. Even the largest companies exhibit, like a Panasonic or an Intel, they love the fact that we are out there saying, this show is not for you. This show is for the startup. And that's what drives our economy, that's what drives the show, and that's what's very exciting.
Awesome.
Well, everyone in chat room is saying that your passion is infectious, and they are happier now that you have joined us. So thank
you
so
up.
Much.
So thanks. I know
you
have
for having me.
We're so glad you were able to take some time out to come here and hang out with us. So thank you very much for that.
Just invite me back.
We will.
Absolutely.
We will.
Anytime.
And Callie has to run. I have to leave set as well. Yep, you're going to go visit the folks at Kaleidoscape.
Correct, and you've got a company called Securify here.
Securify is here. So, Gary, we'll let you do your thing.
Okay,
thanks for stopping by.
Thank you.
And we will see you later on.
Thank you.